All right, so we're going to commence the committee of revision. First item on the agenda is declarations of interest. I do have to declare a declaration of interest on item number one, local improvement for Mantic Hillside Gardens. My brother owns a home there, so therefore I have to declare. In that case, seeing as that only leaves us with one member of the committee, that item has been deferred to October 30th at 2 p.m., if I'm not mistaken. All right. So on to item number two, which is local improvement Mantic Core. Sorry, I missed that. Confirmation of the minutes of the meeting of June 24th. We've never had a committee revision.
No.
So there is no minutes.
June 24th.
But we didn't have a committee revision then. It was quarter revision. Okay, never mind. Anyways. Confirmation of the minutes carried. Moving on. So item number two on the agenda is Mantic Core, local improvement. I just want to quickly, before the presentation, we just have these two technical amendments. Do you want to do these after the presentation, or does it matter?
Mr. Chair, I think it'd probably be helpful after the presentation.
Perfect.
One deals with frontage, one deals with the name.
Perfect. All right, so I hand it over to Kelly.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and members of the committee. We have a relatively short presentation. This one is specific to the core. Before we get into the core, I just want to touch a little bit about overall servicing to Manitic, because it has some obviously some relevance to the core specifically. So the provision of central wastewater services to Manitic has a very long history. We're not going to speak to that today, but it does date back to the 1990s. The more recent history with respect to the City of Ottawa as it currently is configured dates to 2002 and 2003, when a master plan and trunk services concept study was completed and brought to the committee. And it talked about connecting the village to the central system, the village being the entire Manitic area, providing capacity for the entire village, allowing gradual extension, and putting a priority, if you will, on Hillside Gardens and the core area. In 2005, a report on that extension was taken to council and approved. There were two directions to staff. One was that staff were to proceed with detailed design for the trunk wastewater services and the local sewers for the two priority areas, being Hillside Gardens and the core, and that staff were to help facilitate preparation of local improvement petitions. So with respect to the overall area, the system, as you can expect, is designed to take sewage wastewater flows for the full extent of the village at build-out. The city is basically front-ending the cost and recovery over time through two mechanisms. One is those existing areas that are in place within the village is through local improvements, upon council approving the local improvements and any future development. The design obviously would have to be undertaken as a whole to respect the public service area, but there are two distinct petitions, one for Hillside Gardens, as you've heard today, that's deferred to October 30th, and one for the core area. To deal with that, supporting infrastructure, or the major infrastructure, if you will, requires a main sewage pumping station and about 6.6 kilometer of force main. There's approximately 220 meters of trunk sewer that extends from the pump station location to the core petition area, and 477 meters of outlet sewer from the Hillside Gardens petition area along West River Drive to a river crossing that's approximately 270 meters long. So this is the overall area, the green being the service area, if you will, that the overall design had to consider. The two red boundaries are the petition areas that were confirmed for the core and for Hillside. Preliminary indications were that the pump station was going to be located approximately opposite Hillside's garden as a result of some technical issues and sensitive soils. The final emplacement for the pump station was further removed from Hillside Gardens, hence the outlet along West River Drive had to be built to provide that outlet. With respect to the core itself, the project is undertaken under the provisions of the Municipal Act, Regulation 58606. It was a petition request from property owners to specifically provide sanitary sewers and service connections up to the property line. The petition limits were originally set up to obviously within the public service area as it's defined. For generally those areas that had access to existing public water mains. And because of topography, there was the original petition area was looked at to for those areas that could be served without having to build a second pump station. Prior to the petition being finalized, there were some slight modifications to the fringe areas that were requested from various property owners within the community and reviewed, and to the extent that they could be accommodated without impacting others, they were. The final core area, petition area, is outlined with the red hatched line. Pump station is to the northwest of the core petition area, and as I mentioned earlier, there's a trunk sewer that extends between the pump station and the core area. The petition was certified by the city clerk in October of 2007 with 67% of the owners representing 75% of the assessed value of the area having signed in favor. The approvals followed in March 2008 at Agricultural and Rural Affairs Committee and subsequently Council in April of 2008. Not long after that, bylaw 208 of 160 was passed to undertake the work as a local improvement. As far as actual construction goes, and there may have been some comment to this in just prior, the work, physical construction started in 2009. It has in fact continued into 2013, and we still have some minor works to clean up. The major infrastructure, pump station and force main, was in fact commissioned in July 2010. That allowed the connections of houses to proceed at that time. As I mentioned, there is still some work ongoing. The costs, however, that may affect the charge are known. Although the work may still be ongoing, the legislation permits that if the cost of the project has reached or exceeded a level of 75% of what's estimated, then the charge can be assessed at that point in time, which is in fact the case. So the Manictic core area, what pieces of the major supporting infrastructure has supported? Obviously the sewage pumping station and 6.6 kilometers of force main and the 220 meters of trunk sewer between pump station and petition area are necessary in order to get the sewage from the core area to the central system. Within the petitioned area, there's approximately 3.6 kilometers of sewers, some local, some of trunk size, and 170 sewer laterals that were installed. Petition also covered costs associated with any road reinstatement that was, in fact, required as a result of installing the sewers. I just want to point here that even though there's some major infrastructure in the form of trunk sewers, pump stations, and force mains, attributed to the core area, they're only attributed their representative share based on the area served. This is just a visual again, showing the topography, air photo, pump station to the west of the core area with the 220 meters of trunk sewer. This is in fact the area that that was ultimately serviced for the core, representing the 3.6 kilometers within those boundaries. In terms of cost apportionment for this local improvement, when the approvals were sought through Agricultural and Rural Affairs Committee as well as Council, the basis of the cost apportionment was that when it came to supporting infrastructure and, in fact, the trunk sewers in the petition area, that the owners, property owners within the petition area pay their representative share. The city carries the balance. If there was coordinated work to be undertaken, then that was paid 100% by the city. Owners are not affected by that expenditure. Road reinstatement, as I mentioned, only those areas impacted by the sewer construction are attributed to the petition area. The balance is picked up by the city. When it came to the local sewers in the petition area, those are 100% attributable to the benefiting properties, as well as service connections. The point I want to make here as well is that when it comes to the local sewers and the service connections, the city treats themselves as any other property owner with respect to the properties that we in fact own. So we have a share in that as well. A few special considerations and adjustments that were brought forward and at the time of approvals and have carried forward to establishing the charge. All of these provisions, in fact, revert back to an additional cost on the city's share. The first one, at the time of petition, the legislation was in a state of change. At the time of petition, the local improvements were governed under Regulation 11903. That particular regulation had provisions that the cost of work at street intersections was to be borne by the municipality. By the time the local improvement was approved in 2008, the new legislation, 580-606, no longer held that provision. The city, however, held true to what we had stated at the time of the petition and is incurring the costs at street intersections. There was also at the time of petition recognition through functional design and very preliminary design stages that there were six properties that, although they could avail themselves of the sanitary sewer, it would be at a reduced level of service. They would have to install grinder pumps. So it was acknowledged that the city would provide reductions to those properties, and that in fact is still the case. There were reductions to two properties within the limits of the petition area where the floodplain limits infringe, if not entirely on the property or to a significant extent, and those two properties have been provided a reduction. That was also known at the time of petition and approval. The for those of you who are familiar with the Village of Manotick, the Village Walk development had an on-site treatment facility and operating for quite some time. As part of the provision of central services, that on-site treatment facility was decommissioned and they are now connected. However, any cost related to decommissioning was borne by the city, not the petitioned area. And the last item, which is current practice for the city, is that at the time of petition, people need to have some sense of cost certainty. So the city provides estimates, and that translates into cost caps, saying that if the cost of the work exceeds those caps, the city will respect the cap. If the cost of the works is less than those caps, the property owners receive the benefit of the lower costs. All of those provisions were part of the approvals and are in fact in play as part of the charge in front of you today. In terms of calculating the charge, there are two components to it. There is the mainline sewer, which is essentially the main pipes in the roadway or easements, if you will. That includes whether they're local or trunk. The regulations provide that the assessment of that mainline charge can be based on a value and area, which is in fact what our practice is. That's really necessary where if you simply look at the dimensions of a lot, it really isn't representative of relative benefit from property to property. So you can have odd-shaped lots that, although the frontage is entirely different, one larger, one smaller, they may in fact be the same area, and that is why that provision is there, and that's the provision that we work under. This, again, was part of the approvals or made aware as well as communicated, pardon me, at the time of petition. The second component of the charge is for service connections. This is the short section of pipe, if you will, that runs between the mainline sewers and stops at the property line, but still within easements and road allowances. That's assessed on the basis of the cost of each service connection that the property owner has availed themselves of. In terms of the overall project costs, at the top of this slide and shaded is what had been presented at the time of approval in 2008. The lower part of the slide is, in fact, our final construction estimates to completion. You'll note there that we have reference to total overall project cost in the order of $35 million. That's generally consistent between when we sought approval and what we see as the final cost. That included everything. The cost of servicing is approximately $26.7 million, final estimates, and that's essentially what it would take to bring the servicing to the village. As I mentioned earlier, there are two local improvements combined. The final estimates place those at about $10.3 million, some $2 million less than we had estimated. The core local improvement area is approximately $6 million or $5,950,000 is what the final estimates are for the core local improvement. At the time we sought approvals, that estimate was in the order of about 7.5. In terms of how that translates to the charge, again, there are two components. If I relate back to those, the mainline sewers, as our estimated final costs for the core area, are about $5.4 million. The sanitary sewer laterals, the final costs there are estimated at $533,000, roughly. As I mentioned, the city's practice at the time of petition is to provide some sense of cost certainty. At the time of petition, we had indicated, the city had, that is, that the mainline sewer portion of the core area would not exceed $3.5 million. That is, in fact, what's being applied to the charge recoveries. Similarly, at the time of petition, we had thought the service connections would be in the order of $815,000, when, in fact, their final costs are $533,000. It's the $533,000 that's being assessed to the property owners. The short of that is that as a result of the cost cap limits, the city is, in fact, picking up $1.86 million worth of additional cost as a result of estimate versus final cost on the mainline sewers. In from an overall perspective then, as has been mentioned prior, but in one table here, the total costs for the local improvement area are $5.949 million. Because of the mainline sewer cost cap provisions of $1.86 million, the recoverable amount to the property owners is about $4 million. From the city's perspective, we've taken on intersections as we had committed in our earlier communications. We have properties, we have frontage, and a number of special considerations, reductions that amount to another $1.1 million. The end of that is that the property owners, other than the city, are looking to be charged $2.986 million. Overall, the city's costs are roughly same order magnitude, slightly less, but overall the city is picking up $2.96 million, just shy of 50% of the overall local improvement costs for the core area. Just a short note here in terms of material that might have changed since the notices originally went out to property owners. There has been a change. At the time, the draft assessment roll was provided and made available to the public at local libraries and, in fact, the city clerk's office. There was a interest rate targeted for those who were looking to extend the recovery or payments over a longer term at 5.2%. Since the publishing of that draft report, the interest rate has been confirmed to be, in fact, 5%. The roll that was included with the report to the committee revision reflects the 5% interest rate. That is my presentation.
Did just before I begin these two technical motions here, I just wanted to ask a quick question to Ms. Simlick on the, I think it would be you, on the interest rate. Obviously, 5 is better than 5.2, but I noticed on the Navin Road one, which is a smaller time period for repayment, it was 3.65. Can you just explain why this one's higher?
Mr. Chair, the reason for the difference, it's actually the Navin Road is 3.5. Okay. The difference is the length of time. We go out and we try to get as close as possible to what we would pay as the city. And right now, for 20 years, which is what this one is, we would pay 5%. And for 10 years, we would pay around 3.5%. So it's just the way the bond market works, what our cost of borrowing is.
So I'm just going to let, go ahead. Sure.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just got one question for Kelly, I can't see your last, Mr. Martin. Thank you. In terms of on slide number 12, you mentioned the six properties, that there was a value reduction because of, I guess, the extra pumping that they may have had or required to do. Any idea what the value of that reduction was? Or would you have that number?
I don't have the total tally for that. If you bear with me, perhaps I can get that before the committee adjourns today.
But thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
So, Councilor Kadri, did you want to move the two technical motions there?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And these are two technical motions amendments moved by myself. The first one is on the item number two, that the special assessment roll for Lot E, Maple Avenue, be adjusted to show property owner 2353520 Ontario Inc. is in place of property owner 1301965 Ontario Inc. So that's just a reference change on the property ownership. The second motion, Mr. Chair, refers to same item. And it is that the special assessment roll for 1160 Beaverwood be adjusted in accordance with the following: roadway frontage of 444.83, adjusted local improvement frontage, which is no charge, of 986.67, and roadway frontage adjustment of 541.84. And those are two technical amendments that need to be made on the item. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
So we'll deal with those at the end of the meeting. Just to clarify, though, they don't have any impact on any costs, if I'm not mistaken.
They do not, although I expect you will hear from the owner of 1160 Beaverwood as to seeking further changes.
Right. Sorry, it's just that the special assessment roll for Lot E, Maple Avenue, be adjusted to show 2353520 Ottawa Inc. in place of 1301965 Ottawa Inc.
I will give him a copy of the motion, Mr.
Chair.
That would
be ideal. All right, so we're going to go at this point, we're going to go to delegations. And first on the list is Mike Campbell, representing Rideau Nonprofit Housing, which is also known as Highfield Place. Yeah, we give them 10 minutes here. So just to let everyone know, delegations have 10 minutes at the Committee of Revision. And if there's anyone else who hasn't signed up to speak, I believe Everyone has, but if anyone hasn't signed up to register to speak, there's sheets over at the front door. All right, Mike, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to also introduce Rich McDonald, who's the treasurer of our board at Rideau Nonprofit Housing. I'm the secretary of the board. And our chairman, Brian Dorling, is unable to attend today. We're here in his place. I'd also like to thank Kelly Martin and Rosemary Terrio for their help in us making here today. The really only one point we want to make is that, well, I want to set, one point is that the assessment against Rideau Nonprofit Housing represents about 60% of our annual income, so it's an extremely heavy burden on a nonprofit organization, and we don't have profits to offset it. But the point I wanted to make is that whereas our property is on there, 5581 Dr. Leach Drive, and we have Eastman Drive Avenue on the east side and Dr. Leach on the west side. At the northeast corner, there is the corner of our property. We could easily, in fact, we had a fully functional septic system, which was working well. We have lots of property, so it wasn't a problem. We have 30 units, so we weren't a big burden on the local environment. We could easily have made our connection from that point where that pointer is to our property, to our building, and the sewer could have terminated there. However, the city decided that it had to extend the sewer along the eastern border of our property to the southern edge, so that it could extend the sewer off to the new Minto development. There was no requirement of that for us. So basically, we believe that this is beyond the core. The extension was beyond the core and was extended to provide service to yet undeveloped area now being developed by Minto. As a result, we've been charged for something like 270 meters of sewer length, where we probably could have been perfectly comfortable with something less than maybe 20 meters. And the difference in assessment to us is really untenable. It's a burden we really have no means to cover. So we're a nonprofit organization, and many of our tenants are there under rent geared to income, and the rest are at a very modest rent, and it's for independent living of seniors. So that's our case, and I really can't add much more than that to it.
Can I just get? I know that. Thank you first for coming down here today and presenting. Can I just get Mr. Martin? I know you've been working with Highfield on this issue. If you can just provide the court or the committee with some of the feedback from what you've received, some of the potential way forward.
Mr. Chair, the local improvement regulation that the committee is operating under, subsection 6 of section 12, provides that council can allow that exempt properties do not have to pay local improvement. Yeah. However, if council does not take any action, the default is that they pay. So I note that Rideau Nonprofit did sign the petition. They signed it on the basis of a cost that I think Mr. Martin can confirm is similar, if not more than what they are now being asked to pay. So that was the information available to Rideau Nonprofit at the time. Having said that, the decision with respect to tax-exempt properties and whether or not they have to pay the local improvement is a council decision. And as of this date, council has not determined to exempt tax-exempt properties.
Right, so I wasn't asking that. It's all good. I appreciate the input, because then I don't have to ask it in the future. But are you at liberty to speak about any correspondence you've had with Highfield Place in the past couple of weeks about how you could come to an agreement about how we can go forward?
Well, in terms of the move forward, I don't have any specific correspondence directly with them, but I can speak to the dialogue that we've had with respect to the charge. Mr. Merck is correct that at the time the petition was being prepared and the information provided to property owners, the charge that was estimated at that time is slightly larger, but basically the same as what is currently being charged. With respect to the charge specific to the property, it is based on area and value, as I mentioned prior, and not specifically frontage of the property. The extension of the sewer to Eastman is, in fact, an outlet for some of the future Mahogany Lands, I believe, is the development. So that would have occurred regardless of where the property chose to connect. I do know, and this is not a direct discussion with the Rideau nonprofit, I do know that because of their provision of social housing, that the nonprofit does have, at this particular point in time, an agreement with the city through social housing to for a number of items, one of which may be assistant from a budget perspective. And my understanding is that agreement is currently in place until 2017. So there may be some potential there for interim relief until the term of the agreement.
Yes, we're aware that the city has indicated, the housing people have indicated, they could provide relief till our agreement ends in 2017. Thereafter, we have no source of additional income, which amounts to a considerable amount per. We have 30 units, so you can imagine how much of a burden this will be on seniors with a very limited budget. But I still contend that that line would have gone in regardless of whether we agreed or not. It was the city's decision to extend at the end of the property, not ours. We could easily have taken service right from the corner where the CIBC bank is without any impact on our property. It was the city's decision to go beyond that.
But from what I understand, what Mr. Martin's saying is that it wouldn't necessarily be determined on frontage, but on the benefit to the property itself. So regardless as if you just tapped in or if they ran it 20 to 100 meters by, you'd still be assessed the same based on the benefit that the property receives from the hookup, from the ability to hook up. That's what I gathered, I've heard from Mr. Martin.
That's correct. The actual charge to a specific property is based on area and value, not necessarily
on just the frontage.
Not on footage.
That's correct.
No.
Although the assessment, when it arrived, it does indicate that the charge is against 270 meters of frontage.
Yeah.
Yes, you are correct. The regulation states that assessing the charge is to be on the basis of frontage. And so there to impose the charge, we have to relate it back to a frontage measurement, and that measurement is not specifically the frontage that you would typically associate with your tax bill. Rather, it's the length of the property abutting the works, which is in the legislation, and that frontage is then adjusted to respect area and value. So the short of that is that, yes, we have to use frontage to place it on the roll, but the charge is, in fact, estimated and calculated on the basis of area and value.
All right. Do you have questions, Councillor Cotchie? I want to thank you for coming.
Is it my understanding, then, that that we would now have to petition the council?
Well, this committee can't exempt you from the charge. I do have a close working relationship with the councilor for that area, and and I can discuss it with him in the future.
Well, my point is, do we have to make a formal petition to the council, or can we expect you as our local councillor do that?
Yeah, actually, I'm just chair of this committee. I'm not your councillor right now. It's a really confusing
thing. But you are a councillor as well.
I'm just asking the question.
Do you want us to make a formal petition?
I can just promise you the councillor will work with you on it after the meeting. It's a really awkward situation. So our next speaker is John and Margaret Harrison on what files? On 5565 Dickinson Street.
Good morning.
Thank you, Mr. Harrison. Just a reminder, as I said to the last speaker, you have 10 minutes.
Yes, okay. Just a, by way of, oh, by the way, I'm John Harrison. My wife's not here at the moment. She's working. By way of explanation, I'll just give you a little bit of a background. Our property is located at the corner of Dickinson and Courier Street in the village core. And there are six properties, including ours, that extend from the corner of Dickinson and Courier to the dead end located to the south end of Dickinson Street. And these properties, with exception of ours, were allowed to vote whether they wanted the sewer line to extend down to the end of Dickinson Street. And the reason that they were allowed to vote is the fact that they all require pumping. The city hired a company to measure our property, and they said that we could gravity feed. So we weren't part of this petition. And so these properties, I'm not sure what the vote was, I think it was 3 out of 5. They all voted, so the majority carried, that they didn't want to have the sewer line come down, so the sewer line didn't come down towards that, that end of the end of Dixon, pardon me. And so when they actually came and dug up our place to hook up to the sewers, they discovered in the middle of the construction that I couldn't gravity feed. I would need to have a pumping. And so we elected not to have pumping because we didn't want to have pumping at all. And so they repaired it all and all that sort of stuff. And I got the claim back from the city quite promptly, by the way. And so I was pleased with that. My point here, the notice of objection, is the fact that if the city had measured our property correctly in the first place, we would have voted against the sewer like our neighbors who were allowed to. And we weren't given this option as a result of an engineering error. I think we're out by an inch and a half, I believe. And so if we were given the option of opting out like our neighbors, the sewer line would have only gone to the corner of Courier and Dickinson, rather than extending east on Courier down towards the river for 24, 25 meters. And we would be in the same position as our immediate neighbors. So we are facing a tax bill for a service that we were not given the opportunity to decline, given the pumping issue. We would have, and in fact did decline, once the miscalculation by the city was discovered. So we regard this tax bill as unfair and inequitable, as we were not given the same opportunity to decline this local improvement, unlike our neighboring properties, with which we share the same issue of requiring pumping. Thank you.
Councillor Cadre.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just got a question to staff based on the delegation's comment about not being given the opportunity to opt out because of the, what was found or discovered. Could you comment on that, please?
Yes. Prior to the finalization of the petition, as I mentioned briefly in the presentation, the lead petitioners in both cases, Hillside and the core, but particularly in the core, had identified some particular areas that residents had expressed an interest of the potential to not be included. and the local improvement petition, once a petition area is confirmed, it's not a case of being in or out, but prior to the petition, the boundary can be considered. The only involvement there, if you will, from the city's perspective, is that we indicated to the those in interest of changing the boundary of the potential local improvement was that we would entertain that, provided that it didn't put somebody who was in favor of the servicing at jeopardy of not getting it. So, in other words, if a collection of folks were desiring to change the petition area to not be included, we would certainly entertain that, provided it didn't affect somebody who did in that collection of properties. So my recollection in this particular instance is that was the case for the properties that the individual has mentioned, and the majority of them indicated that they did not have any interest, and there, by virtue of not extending the sewer, if you will, to service them, it did not impact anybody who wanted to have provision of the service. In the case of this particular property, as was mentioned, I believe it is a corner lot. At the time that this was being discussed, there was a property on the opposite side of the street. I think it's Courier or Courier. That, to our knowledge, was still interested in the sewer service. By virtue of that, we could not eliminate the sewer fronting that property across the street, which, by virtue of frontage or abutting the works, meant that 5565 had to remain in the petition area. So it wasn't a case of 5565 being necessarily in the same circumstance as the rest of the property owners, by virtue of the fact that he was on a corner lot and a property opposite to him on the other side, in fact, was still interested in the sewer. I'm not sure if I was able to answer your question or not.
The last comment that you made about servicing the property across the street, they paid for some of the improvement or local charges, but how does that affect the property at the public delegation is speaking about?
So any property that that abuts the work and is in the petition area gets assessed a portion of the charge, and that charge is based on area and value of the property. So the property across the street from 5565 would have been assessed on area and value, as would have 5565 Dickinson. The initial charge would have been based on area and value for the property. As was indicated, it became apparent at the time of construction that to take advantage of the service, 5565 would have had to make use of grinder pump. We have taken that into account in the charge by, in fact, providing the reduction to the property as a result of a reduced level of service, and I believe 5565 is being reduced by 60% of what it would have been charged had it been serviced by gravity.
So just coming back to, again, your last comment, Mr. Martin, that the 5565 property did receive a reduction in charge based on the service that was delivered.
That's correct.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
May I comment? The sewer line could have gone to the corner of Courier and Dickinson and gone west along Courier towards Main Street. Had they measured our property correctly, because the property that is on opposite us on Dickinson Street could have hooked into the sewer without extending the sewer down Courier towards the river. They extended the sewer down, as far as I understand, from the corner of Dickinson and Courier down towards the river in order to hook up both properties, my neighbor on Dickinson Street and ourselves. Had they measured properly, they could have just gone directly from the corner of Dickinson and Courier to Main Street without extending it 25 meters towards the river. That's how I understand it. There may be an engineering thing somehow, but I would my point is that if they connected the sewer directly to the corner and west on Courier, there's no way that we could have hooked up.
So just to staff again and maybe following up to what Councilor Kadri was discussing, if 5565 had the opportunity to opt out, as did the rest of the, you know, the properties south of him along along Dickinson Street, what would that have changed the way in terms of you installing the pipe?
I would suggest it would change nothing, because the design of the sewer network is intended to capture as many properties as possible within the public service area, so that coming back after the fact to install a short piece of section of pipe would not occur. Without getting into the specifics and reviewing an entire new design to determine whether one property would be targeted for servicing or not, what impact it would have, I would suggest to you that it would not have any significant change in the routing of the sewers.
So if they had opted out, would they still be assessed?
If they abut the works, they wouldn't be assessed.
All right, so the only reason why the other, obviously, is because they're further down, and we didn't run the pipe down there.
That's correct.
Interesting. All right.
So I understand what you're saying is that the line would have gone, regardless whether we were able to gravity feed, the line would have gone east on Courier towards the river. Is that what you're saying? Not at all?
To be honest, I'd have to take that back and look at that. I don't have the lay of the land and topography in front of me. But what I'm trying to convey to you is that the sewer network is designed in a way to accommodate as many properties as possible, and the routing is based on that. The opting in or out of a singular property along the length of the line would highly unlikely change that routing, is what I'm trying to convey.
So I don't really think you answered Mr. Moffitt's question, really, because he's saying to you, would the line have gone east on Courier had my property been measured properly? And you're saying it would have, and I'm saying it would not have.
It's an interesting part of town, right, because Courier automatically goes downhill. Same with Ty, same with O'Grady. They go when they go east of Dickinson Street, they head downhill. So anyone down there would have to pump it up. That's why we don't go down. That's why we haven't gone down there. So I'm not, I guess that's, would we have run it east down Courier if 5565 was not a part of the local improvement?
If you bear with me and allow me a few moments to actually look at the lay of the
we have other speakers, so there's plenty of time.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Harrison. Our next speaker is Chris Napier, but okay. I'm sure he'll text me later and tell me what he wanted to talk about. All right, so we then move on to David Johnston and Michael Bradley, representing Lee Merck Developments, and Michael Mursky.
David Johnson, we're with the Mike Bradley, we're with the Altus Group, and generally we deal with property assessment and municipal taxation. However, our client has asked us to review the charges applied to them and the fairness involved. We have a presentation for you. Do you want to have it?
Oh, yeah.
basically a synopsis of what we're going to say, so it gives you something to review. We sort of are coming at this from a technical point of view. Basically, as you can guess, we've never done this before, so it should be interesting. It's our opinion that the methodology employed by the City of Ottawa creates an unfair and inequitable levy charge applied to the subject property, Manitic Mews. Basically, they're being assessed 17.19% of the total charges. The methodology applied by the city incorporates both the current value assessment and the site area as a percentage of the total affected properties and does not take into consideration the actual frontage as specifically defined in Ontario Regulation 586.06, Section 12, Subsection 1BI. Under Section 12, it says cost of improvement under B specifically charged the owner's share of the cost by imposing an equal share, a special charge per meter of frontage. Under one, it says, it says, on the lots that abut directly on the work. We understand that Section 16 allows for reductions and increases to special changes for unique property parcels. It's also our understanding that all properties were calculated using the same methodology, which would conclude that in this instance of local improvement charges, no site is defined as being equal. Under Section 16, it's pretty specific there. It says that sufficient, at the end of 16.1, it says, sufficient to adjust the amount charged on that lot on a just and equitable basis as compared with the other specially charged lots. In this instance, the charges are basically, there's not one property charged according to the Act on the frontage. It's done on area, and it's also done on their assessment. And, okay. So, number four, the site area 4.33 hectares used by the city in the calculation of the adjusted local improvement frontage is not reflective to the actual usable area of the subject site. The appropriate usable area of the subject site is estimated to be approximately 3.55 hectares. The difference, for all intents and purposes, is what used to be the septic beds. Right at the moment, you can't build on them until you'd have to get a committee of adjustment to it. They'd have to be torn out, remedial work, et cetera, and et cetera. And on top of that, the assessment department has applied an income approach to this property, and they've never added any additional charges to it. And dealing with using the current value assessment may or may not reflect the actual market value and has no relationship to the benefit received by the installation of the sanitary sewer. Basically, my previous job before being this consultant here was I was a valuation manager with MPAC, and valuation has very numerous ways. It's not an exact science. As an example, property right across the road from our subject property, where the ball dam is there, owned by the city, has a value of $1.782 million on it. Well, a lot with about 10% the size that's owned by a private individual has got $498,000. So it's an inexact science. To use that in the calculations, in our opinion, is incorrect. Based on the above, we believe the actual frontage of 401.55 meters, which doesn't necessarily agree with, we don't necessarily agree with the frontage, but we'd like to thank Mr. Martin for giving us the information. That's what this has been calculated, and I believe there was an adjustment made earlier on today on that. We believe if you're going to do it, you should be doing it on the frontage, and it should be calculated and should be employed in calculating the local improvement charge. Using the city's actual unit cost of $520,000 per meter. The estimated total levy charge to be applied to this property would be, I guess, reuse 401 meters at $520, came up $208,806. Adding the sewer lateral charge of $15,000, you come up to $224,000. If you're using the other number of 440, it'd be $248,000, not the $528,000 our client has been presently assessed. Again, we appreciate the assistance we have received from the City of Ottawa so far. And at this time, it may be appropriate to review the details with calculations with the City. Again, I'd like to say our thanks to Kelly Martin. He has been super helpful for us to get through the numbers and figuring out exactly what was applied, who was applied. I'd like to make one point on the calculations used. The effective frontage, Mike can verify the numbers, but by using the effective frontage, I think of it, what was it, 30% of the properties went down, 70% of the properties actually went down, and about 30% actually went up. Our client went up significantly from 401 to 900.
First of all, I want to, well, thank you for coming. I also commend you for admitting that you used to work for MPAC. I don't know many people that would readily admit their MPAC association in public.
Yeah, well, I'm a consultant now.
wouldn't the MPAC assessment be more beneficial on this kind of a charge than a market value assessment? I mean, one would assume that taking into consideration a property of that size with full hookup to municipal services would be assessed much higher in terms of a market value than the impact value.
Not necessarily, because that property, actually I reviewed that property from the client's point of view. I'm hired by Limerick, and it's based on an income approach. This is where market value just isn't working for this type of calculation. They use an income approach based on the net operating income of that property, and they come up with a valuation based on that. While the rest of the properties, for the most part, are residential, and that they use basically a model of cost. So the two systems aren't really synonymous.
Mr. Martin, is there anything you can, or Mr. Mark, anything you can provide a committee based on the presentation?
I can respond to the legal point, Mr. Chair, which is appropriate for me to do. At the outset on Manotick in the petition, it was noted that the city would be utilizing, and this was recommended to council, would be utilizing 16.5, which provides that a reduction or increase shall be made in the amount to be specially charged on a triangular or regularly shaped lot sufficient to adjust that amount on a just and equitable basis as compared with other specially charged lots having regard to the situation, value, and the superficial area of the lot. And so staff recommended the use of two of those three criteria, being the area and value. This was reflected in the report. This was reflected in the bylaw approving the works. And I note again that the amount that is being sought in respect of these properties is similar to or less than the number that they signed on to when they signed the petition. So this information was available to them when they signed the petition, and they signed.
Can I address that? We were hired to review the fairness of it. All acts I've dealt with, and I've dealt with the Assessment Act, Municipal Act, all are for the fairness of distribution of costs. And in this case, it's our opinion that this methodology is not the fairest distribution of cost. It's as simple as that. The actual cost of these pipelines are along the frontage, and they haven't even taken the frontage into consideration in their calculations.
I would have to imagine it's somewhat difficult when you're dealing with the Manotick Mews, as it's a wholly owned, insulated property with limited frontage. I mean, the frontage is really only on what, Courier, Beaverwood, and O'Grady, if you really want to go with frontage. But the roads inside, the mews, are all wholly owned by Leemark. So how would, I mean, obviously you have to have a different formula so that it can be somewhat equitable to, let's say, the properties on Mantic Main Street, which are single properties that are assessed at, you know, anywhere from $15,000 to $20,000. How many stores are in the mews? They don't have that same frontage. So how do you come up with a formula? And I can understand why it would be different. Kelly?
Natural frontage, what has been used? Sorry.
I'd ask Mr. Martin to respond.
Sorry, Mr. Martin.
Yes. Well, that is, in fact, what our experience has been with local improvements, is that when you look at, and the core is probably a strong example of that. None of the lots there are of particularly regular shape and size. When it comes to frontage, you're correct. This particular property would have limited street frontage, if that's the measure that's being referred to, relative to the length of the property that abuts the work. And so in our experience, what we've tried to do is to try and normalize, and with following the guidance of the regulation, we've looked at area and value as the means to do that. I do want to point out that in the regulations, the definition for frontage, in fact, speaks to the limit of the lot that abuts the work. And so when we look at, for the purpose of local improvements, frontage, we're speaking to the extent of the property that abuts the work, in this particular case, a sewer. This property abuts sewer on Beaver Pond, on Beaverwood, Currier, and Eastman, as well as the full length of the easement that runs between Beaverwood and Eastman, and the easement. So I guess the short answer to your question is that there is a multitude of ways that you could try and come up with formulas and reductions in length and whatnot, but there's no possible way that we could have a standard way of doing it that way. By looking at area and value, it is a consistent means that we apply to all properties. And I would just want to comment that when it does come to sanitary sewers, area is a contributing factor to the potential service that one can avail themselves of. Area is used in the calculation of volume of sewage, because potentially you could, subject to zoning, you could develop to a greater or lesser extent depending on the size of a property, if the zoning permits it. And that development to a larger or lesser extent will influence the volume of sewage, so that area is in fact a reasonable means of looking at equitable between properties of different size.
When the petition was originally signed, I have to assume that Leemark signed it, otherwise it probably wouldn't have been approved. The original estimate that was sent to them, do we know what that original estimate was that they agreed to when they signed the petition?
Yes, Mr. Chair. In respect of, hold on. Just give me a moment, Mr. Chair.
Yeah. That's all I have are moments.
I don't have it, sorry.
That's fine.
I'd help you if I did.
I have an email from Mr. Martin that I'll call up, Mr. Chair.
But I know that we've guaranteed all the estimates, so I know that the charge today that we're talking about would be lower than what the estimate was that they approved, if I'm not mistaken. I mean, the time would have been then to argue the charge. I mean, I know you can do it now, but point is, if you agree to a charge at that time, it's reasonable to expect that same charge is going to come forward when the assessments are to be finalized.
Just to your question, the notice of March 2007 had identified $518,300 as the charge for 1160 Beaverwood, and an estimated cost of the service lateral of $5,000. So that would equate to a total charge of $523,300, which is consistent, I believe, with what is currently provided to them.
It's 528,000.
So we're over our guaranteed estimate by $5,000.
There are two components to it. Is the main line? The main line had the cap on it. The service connection did not have a cap of.
Could I address that issue of getting a letter back in 2008 and reviewing it at that point in time? I think the purpose, my understanding of the purpose of this meeting is also is what's the fairness involved? They never knew what everybody else was getting either. They knew what the charges might have been applied to them. I'm saying, is this the fair method of applying it? I mean, the act is pretty explicit. It says all the other people should have been used on frontage. Nowhere does it say that you center straight on area and assessment of all things.
So if, let's say, just for fun, that the Black Dog, which has much more frontage than Robinson's Independent Grocer, by your definition, the Black Dog would be assessed much higher than Robinson's because Robinson's has no frontage. Is that fair? I realize you're arguing fairness on your behalf, but go ahead.
I think what Dave's trying to get at is that Section 12 of the regulation was never taken into account. They used Section 16 explicitly, but the intent of the legislation was for all normal properties to be based on frontage and special cases to be based on assessment and site area. And in this case, no other property was used as frontage. So if they're treating all the properties the same, then there's no special or unique properties in this instance of the local improvement charge.
Mr. Martin, can you respond to that?
Mr. Chair, it is true that 16.5 has been consistently applied throughout the core area, that staff in all cases looked at the area and the value of the lot. That was what was undertaken to do in 2008. That's what was approved by council. And as you heard from Mr. Martin, it's staff's view that considering the circumstances of Manotick, this was an appropriate way to come up with a just and equitable basis for the charge.
All right, I'm going to thank Mr. Johnson, Mr. Bradley for the presentation. And we will move on to the next presentation, which is Alan Haunt with the Manotick Legion.
Thank you.
Mr. Hahn, you have 10 minutes.
Okay, I also would like to have a bit of a background. I represent I'm a member of a branch 314 of the Royal Canadian Legion located in Manotick, 5550 Ann Street, right in the core. We got the sewers. We like the sewers. We needed the sewers. That's not the issue. You may recall, Mr. Councillor, Mr. President, that our branch burned down 2003, and we were in temporary quarters for a number of years. And then in 2007, we finally occupied a new building. Now, as part of that process, we were mandated to install a septic system to last, to serve until we were going to get hooked up to the sewers, because these two projects kind of went pretty close back to back and coincided to a certain degree. At the time, we did request if we could please hook up to pumping tanks, which is what we had before the place burned down, feeling that would cost a lot less money than putting in a temporary septic system. That request was denied, and the resulted in a cost of approximately $35,000 to install a septic system. It was part and parcel of the permit to rebuild is that the septic system would have to be removed within 6 months after getting hooked to the sewers, which would come down soon after completion of our building. And this is exactly what happened. I believe that the specific reason for the removal of the septic system was that the city mandated that we create parking space in our location. And we did that. We also had really no awareness that there would be a bill coming for the hookup. The hookup was done in 2006 2007. I'm not too sure of the time frame. And Legion organizations in the city of Ottawa don't receive an annual tax bill. We are thankfully exempt from city taxes. So when by the time that we got our building hooked up to the sewer system, the parking lot was in place, the trees were up, and the landscaping was approved, we got a clean bill of health from the city, and the city returned the deposit to us. And it was our belief at that time that we had fully met all the conditions for occupancy of our facility. So when this bill showed up about a month or so ago, it was a big surprise. Now, you probably know that Legion, specifically our Legion also, is totally nonprofit, 100% operated by volunteers. No doubt you're aware of that. Legion members do not derive any financial benefit from the Legion. The Legion contributes to the welfare of veterans, their families, and our local community. And we simply can't afford it, guys. It's a big bill. Over $16,000 is a lot of money for us. As I said before, we were unaware that this assessment was coming, and accordingly, we did not plan for it. So that's pretty much our story. We don't receive tax bills from the city now. I would ask that the city consider extending that to the sewer hookup. Like I said, we met all the obligations of the permit. We hooked up. We did everything. And we're thankful for the sewers. We're not arguing about that at all. That, in essence, is my plea. Pardon? Yeah. Do you agree, Mr. Past President?
I hope he agrees with you.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Mr. Hahn. I'm sure you heard at the start that it's not, this committee cannot exempt you from these charges. We would have to approve the charges, and then council is the only body that can provide an exemption. As far as I know, there's at least five properties in the core that currently have tax, that are currently tax exempt. It's just the two?
Mr. Chair, I was, I'm certainly aware now of, I was aware before of the Legion and the Rideau nonprofit, and then I also took the opportunity of adding up all the assessment for the churches. I think they were all in the core. You would know better than I. And that was another, the churches were another $85,000. And I'm not aware of any other tax exempt properties.
The churches, are they tax exempt or not?
The churches are subject to the charge.
Sorry, are they taxed?
Churches are subject to the charge in the same way that the Legion...
I get that. I'm asking about taxes. Are the churches tax exempt as the Legion is? Sorry.
Yes, they are. The church, the place of worship is tax exempt.
Okay. So obviously it's something that council will need to consider about how to move forward. But our role is merely to deal with the charges today. And we can't exempt you from that. Councillor Cadre?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And just one question to staff with the comments that the delegation made, that they were not made aware of the charges?
We had no knowledge of the charges.
No knowledge of the charges. Any comments?
Mr. Chair, I don't wish to be repetitive, so I will simply say the petition was signed in 2008. The amount was there. The works were completed, as Mr. Martin said, in 2010.
Thank you.
Well, Mr. Hahn, it would be safe to say that you knew there'd be a cost when you signed on the petition, but what you're saying is that because you were tax exempt, you assumed there wouldn't be any charges on the sewer. Is that correct?
Personally, I'm not aware that we were aware that a charge would result. But like I said, we are thankful for the sewers.
Yeah. All right. I don't think there's any wrongdoing in staff in terms of what they've done in the past. I think everyone was notified, was duly notified, but it's obviously a different circumstance with the Legion. So thank you for your presentation.
Can you give us some indication as to what our next action should be? Should we wish to pursue this?
Pardon me?
We have to go back and review the cases that are presented this morning in front of us, and then as a committee would come back and render a decision. And at that point, if you have any other questions based on that decision, then we can give you some direction that Mr. Mark may not have clarified so far.
Thank you very much.
I think Mr. Mark did clarify one of the positions was that if you are unhappy with the decision of committee, then you have an option to go to council in terms of any relief that you may be seeking.
Thank you very much.
Thank you again. Our next speaker will be Carlos Adamson and Jerry Riesbeck on behalf of Watson's Mill.
Mr. Chair, committee members, city staff, we're pleased to make a presentation on behalf of Watson's Mill. I'm Carlos Adamson, president of Watson's Mill, and to my right is Jerry Riesbeck, vice president of Watson's Mill. What we are seeking today is some forbearance on the part of for a nonprofit organization that has been exempt from taxes. And we don't have sewers, but now we don't have any washroom facilities at all in the building. I'm going to turn over the presentation to Jerry Riesbeck, and he will outline the reasons for our request.
Yeah, thank you, Carlos. Yeah, for clarification purposes, a bit of background might be useful. Watson's Mill Manotick is really one of the 10 Ottawa community museums. And it's a volunteer-led, nonprofit, charitable organization with the mandate to preserve Watson's Mill as a working historic grist and flour mill and a social, cultural, and educational focal point for the community and visitors. As an operating grist mill and a popular tourist site, approximately 50,000 visitors visit the mill during its operating season. Now, the mill is a designated heritage building under bylaw number 3279 because of its architectural and historical value. It's supported in part by the annual grant provided to the community museums through the museum sustainability program and by ongoing fundraising events. All funds are used for the sole purpose of keeping the Mill Museum operational and open for the enjoyment and education of the public. To protect Watson's Mill and keep it in public hands, Watson's Mill Manotick Incorporated became the sole owner of the mill in December of 2008 by purchasing it from the city. Now, we have 3 points that we'd like to make here to justify why we are appealing the assessment and asking for an exemption from the city. First is that the mill itself, it is an 1860 construction. It's unheated. It's an historical building. It has no accessible potable water, toilets, no washroom facilities, and only a very rudimentary electrical service. The building is uninhabitable and basically partly straddling the Rideau River. The only washrooms available that we have in the mill quarter is across the mill square in the carriage shed. Further, the building is vacant and unheated. There are no visitors coming throughout the winter months, so for 6 months of the year, we basically have no need for any sewer connection and certainly no practical reason for one, and it's likely probably not even feasible to do that. The second point we'd like to make is that in May of this year, the mill was fully exempted from property taxes by the Municipal Property Assessment Corporation. And as it is classified as under Property Code 730 in the 700 special and exempt categories. And in view of this exemption, we believe that sewer assessment charges would seem to be inappropriate. And finally, again, as Mr. Adamson has stated, it is a nonprofit organization. It has a very limited budget. It's heavily dependent on continual fundraising just to keep the doors open. Accordingly, from our point of view, the city's imposition of proposed sewer assessment charges would basically constitute only an additional and unnecessary financial burden for the mill, for which we can see no conceivable practical use or benefit. So basically, our conclusion, as has been previously stated, and these are just three very, very relatively simple points that we wanted to make, we ask that in consideration of these points, the city will elect to exempt Watson's Mill from the special 2009-13 sewer assessment charges. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you. So all I can really say is the same thing I said to the Legion. I mean, and you guys know this, that we cannot exempt you, only council can exempt you, and that's something that will have to be looked at after the committee renders its decision.
All right. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I just want to take this opportunity to invite everybody to Watson's Mill before the season closes. Thank you ever so much. It's a beautiful sight.
Thank you. I think you should... Every time I see you in public, I think you should call me Mr. Chair.
Will do. I'll meet you on Saturday.
There you go. Exactly. So I have to declare confidential the next speaker, Ron Corbett. He's written about me negatively, so I may have a bias in his presentation. I'm just joking, Ron. Come on up. It's all in good fun.
I thought
maybe I'm just reading it wrong. So, Mr. Corbett, you have 10 minutes.
Yes, absolutely.
Is this way? Okay. Thank you for the opportunity of speaking here today. Ms. Oliver was here earlier but had to leave. We own a property together not far from Watson's Mill. 5545 Dickinson Street is one of the affected properties. Ms. Oliver gave an affidavit to the city clerk. Do the committee members provided a copy of the affidavit? Have you had a chance to read the affidavit? Is that yes? Sorry. I was hoping to save some time. She filed an affidavit. I was just wondering if you'd have the opportunity to see it. Okay. Well, the Coles Note version, we purchased our property after the petitions, after the votes on council. The first we heard that there was a special levy was exactly 1 month ago, August 26th, on a letter from the city manager. This is the first we found out about this special levy. We are not on the sewers. We're not even using this service. I have no intention of using the service. In the letter from the city manager, he says that relief, I'll quote right from the letter, the city has recently established a policy for relief from such charges for owners who meet the following criteria. We meet criteria 1 and 3. One being we became owners of the property subsequent to the construction or the commencement of the local improvement, and we were unaware of it, and the owners provide an affidavit or statutory declaration stating that they were not aware of the pending local improvement charges at the time they acquired the property. That is us. The issue seems to be number 2, which I've heard raised already at the committee today. At the time of the purchase, a tax certificate was requested, and the tax certificate did not indicate the pending imposition of costs. We did not request a tax certificate. We have title insurance, which is the norm for real estate, residential real estate transactions in the city. We did the standard due diligence. I've actually heard that phrase already today. We certainly did the standard due diligence. We purchased the home, went to a lawyer, hired a lawyer. We certainly were not expecting a hidden tax liability roughly equal to 4 years of property taxes. That in a nutshell is our argument. I think there should be some sort of effective relief. I understand from speaking with Mr. Mark earlier in the week that this issue, I've heard it today in Navin, was raised as an issue. And as far as I know, no insurer has paid out any claim in Navin. They're all being denied. So I put to you that we need effective relief for people in this situation that bought the house. We were not delinquent. We're not negligent in our purchase. We're finding out about this tax bill, you know, 1 month ago. And I think there should be some way for the city to offer effective relief to people in our position. And I would put to you that the effective relief would be setting aside the special levy. That's my presentation.
All right, thank you, Mr. Corbett. I mean, just, can I just ask Mr. Mark the comparisons to Navin, and with, this is something that we've said that that those residents can follow up with you and their own legal counsel on a way forward. Is this similar to that?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
So what would your recommendation be to Mr. Corbett to if this is all approved today, what could be his next step?
So pardon me for being repetitive, but I'm duty-bound to give the caution. He is well advised to seek his own legal advice. It will take at least, staff have committed to coming forward with a position by the end of the year. The local improvement, if the committee of revision were to approve the local improvement today, a bylaw has to go to council to formalize it. It would probably be on the agenda, the second meeting in October, and that would lead to letters going out from finance at some point. I don't know if the treasurer wants to say when the letters will go out. The option I threw out was choose the annual payment option, which means that there'd be no payments before June 2014, and await the outcome of what the city's position is. But people would be well advised to seek their own legal advice.
All right, so you want to...
May I respond just quickly here?
You can provide some comments, yeah?
Yeah, if I can just respond. Again, the city in the letter from the city manager, Mr. Kirkpatrick, is very clear that there is a possibility of relief for people to meet these criteria that, you know, purchase their property after the local improvement. I'm gathering from being at the committee today that local improvements are an issue in various areas of the city. I think the issue of title insurance is something that the committee and the city should look into, because I don't see this offer as being real relief. From speaking to Mr. Mark earlier this week, everyone is being denied. Everybody that puts in a claim to their insurer is being denied. So if my only relief is to put in a claim that is being denied, that's not effective and real relief. It's not a real offer from the city. I think effective relief you may want to consider, Clause 2 reading that a tax certificate was requested. The tax certificate did not indicate the pending imposition of costs, or your claim has been denied, or you are not using the service. You know, because at the moment, nobody is getting relief. And I think there should be some real relief being offered.
Right. I do know that staff are going to look into how we can shore that up and make sure that we are capturing those who were trying to help out but can't. On the issue of not using the service, that would not be a good reason for relief, because that property, it does have the ability to connect, which it never had before. If you wanted to go get a new septic system on that property, first of all, you'd have a hard time because the property is small. Second of all, it would be more expensive than your connection to the sewer. So it would be more advantageous to the property to have a sewer connection than a replacement of a septic system.
The suggestion would be, and that's my second suggestion. My first suggestion is that relief should be you have a tax certificate or your insurer has turned you down, because it is the norm. This is the tricky part about this. It is the norm. The city manager's letter as much as says this, and I'll quote from Mr. Kirkpatrick's letter. The city understands that it is a practice of many, if not all, I would put to you that it is indeed all real estate lawyers and home purchasers to obtain title insurance. When you get title insurance, you rarely get a tax certificate. So, you know, that is one possibility. You could phrase in such a way as the special levy is not payable until we hook up to the sewer. At such time as we hook up to the sewers, then we would pay a special levy. Or I think the real relief would be if your insurer has turned you down. That would be effective relief.
So I said that you have the commitment of staff to look at this, and the intent is that we come up with a solution by the end of the year, and you won't be assessed until next year.
We will not be assessed until next year? So how is this?
That's right. This assessment won't take effect until the 2014 tax year.
Yes, until the following year.
Yeah. So we intend to try to have a solution for this by the end of 2013.
Okay, so the process today, if you vote to go ahead with this levy today...
Your assessment would be activated?
It would be activated.
You'd have... There'd be opportunity in the coming months to address the situation.
Does it not make sense to activate it after you've had this discussion on how you can offer relief?
Well, we don't want to... I think there's time needed to be able to bring these assessments and make sure they're on the 2014 tax roll. There's been... You know, countless residents in Manitic have been asking for this for the past several years to get on with it. I don't want to run the risk of delaying that any further. I think we have some isolated cases that can be addressed regardless. Even if we approve this, I think we can still address some of the concerns.
So if you approve it today, just so I understand the process, if you approve it today, then this issue of the title insurance, the tax certificates, will be raised at council? Is that my understanding?
I almost said councillor, which you kind of are at the same time. Different spelling.
I am but your humble servant, Mr. Chair. Staff can't commit to getting on a council agenda. We can commit to looking at it and responding to councillors, and then a decision will be made on the way forward.
If I was a councillor right now, which I'm not, but if I was, I would say that I'm committed to making sure Mr. Mark gets it on council before the end of the year.
Final question: if the decision at the end of the day is to not amend, you know, clause number 2, or to not offer any relief, is there an appeal? What are my options if this simply goes ahead?
Mr. Mark,
I believe I did have this discussion with Mr. Corbett. Unlike the Court of Revision, you are the final decision-making body. There is no appeal from the Committee of Revision to the Ontario Municipal Board, and so the relief. There is always the ability to go to the courthouse next door and seek to quash a municipal decision, and that is the legal relief that there would be.
So the Court of Revision allowed those to appeal. The Committee of Revision does not.
That's correct, Mr. Chair. In fact, Kemp and Eagleson have been appealed to the Ontario Municipal Board. Leggett and Paget were not, and there's no appeal from this Committee of Revision.
I can't say I understand the change in the Local Improvement Act as to how it's beneficial.
I don't understand either. How can it magically transform back into a court?
You'd have to predate the application to have it be 2005.
Okay. Oh, is that right? Is that how it worked? Okay.
Yeah, it was a change of legislation between 06 and 08, and there was no local improvement applications between 06 and 08.
Fair enough.
So
fair enough.
Yeah.
So the way we're leaving, if you vote for the committee, then the staff are going to try to get before city council. I can speak to you as a councillor for the area, but likely you're going to go ahead with this charge, and I'll leave with this charge added to my property tax bill.
I can't preclude what this committee is going to do before we do it, but if approved, then yes, that would be your best course of action.
And if everybody decides there's more important things to do and it never comes before council, is there some guarantee it's coming before council?
There's nothing more important to do than dealing with the residents of Rideau Glover.
I agree. It's the most... I'm going to leave it right there. Thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it.
Thanks, Ron. Okay, so that was our final speaker. Councillor Cotter, do you have anything to ask of staff before we recess?
No, I'm fine, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
Can I get an update on the Mr. Harrison issue at 5565 Dickinson Street?
Chair, we only have partial information right now. What we can confirm is that the property at 5561 is in fact serviced on Courier. So they are in fact serviced on that section of sewer that extends down to Courier. What we, just for your information, what we have not been able to confirm is whether or not 5561 could have been serviced by gravity onto Dickinson. That we have not been able to confirm, but we can definitely confirm that sewer that extends on Curie is actually being used by the property at 5561.
Have a question?
Thank you. Sorry, Mr. Chair. Just coming back to Mr. Martin on the six properties, the value assessed or the reduction. Can you give me that number, please?
Yes, Councillor. The value of the pumping reductions is $59,441.
Thank you.
All right. So, with no further questions, committee will recess.
Excuse me.
Yes. I don't think we're there. We're not at a point where you can just speak from the crowd. Unfortunately, you had your opportunity to speak. Yeah, apparently there isn't, because of the changes. Right. If you want to follow up, I mean, I don't know what you were told. I can't defend someone else's comments to you. All I can tell you is the reality, and that the Local Improvement Act, with its changes in 2008, states that there is no appeal to a committee of revision decision. That's all I got for you. So we're going to recess. And we'll come back when we get a decision. All right, so the committee has reached a decision, but first, obviously, I want to just address the two amendments. So on the Maple Avenue item, just changing the one Ontario number to another Ontario number.
Carried.
And then the second one is on 1160 Beaverwood, just adjusting the frontage numbers. Carried. All right, so obviously we spoke to each one during the as they came up, each issue that came up, and the committees decided to accept the local improvement as put forward. We think that there's, I mean, what if there maybe six issues that came forward, maybe less, only one of which can't be dealt with in a different way. So you look at, in regards to, let's say, the Legion, the Mill, and of course the churches weren't here to represent themselves, but the churches are kind of involved in that mix, will have to be addressed in a decision of council if that takes place. With regard to 5545 Dickinson Street, we spoke about that one. That has to be worked out with staff. And 5565 Dickinson Street, we need more information on that one, at least in order to make a decision. And we'll approve the assessment on that property today, but we need to know more about the courier connection, and whether or not 5561 could have been connected from Dickinson. Because I understand that, yes, it was connected from Courier, but was that done because you thought you would connect both from Courier? And if you didn't connect at Courier, could you have connected 5561 from Dickinson, thus not requiring the Courier extension? So if you could provide that information following this, whenever you get it, that would be ideal. Mark, Ms. Mark?
Mr. Chair, I'm quickly trying to go through my mind in order to give the committee a viable option. And I have to confess, and I'm struggling to do so, if the committee were to reduce the assessment for that, the special assessment for that property to zero, that has an impact on all the other properties. So it is with some regret that I note that while that particular property is outstanding, the committee cannot approve the special assessment rule and leave that property outstanding. If the committee wishes to look at that further, the only option that has come into my mind, Mr. Chair, is that you would have to adjourn these proceedings to a subsequent date.
Yeah, I guess what I was implying was that the committee won't look at that property in the future. The committee won't. But as with the...
Understood.
Thank you. Similar to the Legion, Watson's Mill, Hatfield Place, there's other avenues for those properties to be looked at.
And as a residential property, that is legally possible. Yes, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. So on the local improvements, item number two for Mantic Core Area Sanitary Sewer Extension.
Carried.
As amended. Carried as amended. So on in-camera items, obviously there's none. Notices of motion, none. Inquiries, none. Other business, none. Adjournment?
So moved.
And the next meeting will be on October 30th at 2 p.m. to deal with Mantic Hillside Gardens. I won't be in attendance, but it will be chaired again by the regular chair, Councillor Harder, and Councillor Cotter will be in attendance as well. Thank you.